attention, please.
I think this is a good idea.
Dreams without goals.
People are getting fed up with corporate America.
I want you to get up. Stand up. Fight back.
Ask what you can do for your country.
Don't call it a comeback.
All right, guys, welcome to another edition of Corner Launch. We just did this 2 seconds ago, but we're going to do it again. My name is Jeremy Griffin. We're broadcasting live from the Pod Shop at Startup Street, 3024 West Swan Avenue. More information on Startup Street at thestartupstreet.com. We are joined once again by my man, Danny Varaki.
Good morning.
Bringing the love, my man, Andrew.
Good morning.
And we got Mike Zara in the house from Tiago National Title.
Good morning. Good morning.
Mike, once again, how are you doing this morning?
I'm doing great.
We're also joined by my man, Greg, from Nicaragua. We've got him live on Zoom. All right, for you guys listening right now on the finished podcast, we're going to attempt to patch this Zoom audio into the podcast and see if we can't figure that out and do the best we can. Otherwise, if you hear somebody asking a question and you can't really hear them, that's what's going on. So maybe I'll paraphrase your questions or something, Greg, or something like that, you know. So Mike just bought a beautiful building down the street. Tiago's got how many offices in how many states now?
I want to say we have 12 or 13 offices in 3 or 4 states, but we do business in about 40.
But you do business in about 40. Okay, cool. So I want to get into what's that like, expanding state by state, how long you've been doing it, the ins and outs, lessons learned. But for our listeners that are not quite sure, what does Title do?
Sure. So essentially what Title Insurance is, it's a protective policy like property and casualty. However, it's for things that occur on a piece of property prior to an actual closing. Property casualty is for future, if your house floods or if there's wind damage or hail. What Title Insurance does, it's for things that people have done in the past. If there is an easement, if there was an open line of credit, if there was a, you know, if there was a fraudulent transfer of an actual deed. It does everything to be able to make sure that you can have the enjoyments of the quality of the product of the property that you're actually purchasing.
And the protection, right?
And the protection. So if anything, like, for example, say I sold you my house, but, for example, I got it through a fraudulent deed, there would be a claim for the title insurance, and then you'd be able to go after the policy for the value of the purchase price so that they either make it right and find the correct person to get the deed signed, or obviously you get paid out for the policy, and then you move on.
Gotcha. So when you guys are doing that, and self-admittedly, I mean, even though – you know, Amber knows what she's she talks to me about this stuff all the time.
And I know, it's like probably like white noise in your ear.
Dude, it goes way over my head. I get it. You know what I mean? It just goes a lot of times.
It's super complicated. No one really gets what we do, but it, you know, is, you know, without being biased, I honestly believe that we have the most important job in the real estate transaction. You know, with the realtor, the lenders, everything involved, the title insurance company is literally, for lack of a better term, the glue of the transaction.
100%.
We bring the buyer. You know, we keep the buyers together, the sellers together. If the realtors are arguing, you know, if the lender's not bringing what they're supposed to bring to the table on time, we literally bring everybody together and say everyone has to play nice. We have to play well together, and we got to get a deal done because there's consumers at the end of the day that are relying on all of us to be professional.
Right.
So what we do is make sure everyone sticks to the deadlines to assure that they get what they paid for.
Gotcha.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So if I bought a house and I came to see you, I had to finance some of it, you'd have to get me title. I'd have to have title insurance.
Correct.
Say I had the house for 7 months and the market spiked 30%. Okay. But now we find out that the title's faulty. Do I get that money back or do I get the money plus what the house is worth now?
No. So essentially, you get the policy, the amount of the policy that you actually bought.
That's it.
And then.
So even if the price escalated and went up 50%.
Even if it decreased 50%, you know, it'd still be the policy amount.
See, because it goes both ways.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah. But however, on outside of that, you know, because in my previous life, I was an attorney as well. I don't practice law kind of outside of the entity anymore. But you would have a civil suit on the other side of it to recoup the difference. Because you were fraudulently induced into a purchase of a transaction, not by the title company, but by the other parties that actually bought or sold the property to you.
Interesting.
Yeah.
See, you're automatically programmed to think the price is going up because we're all living the good life right now in real estate.
I've seen it the
right?
other way where things, you know, yes, take a nosedive. And that was kind of one of the things that, you know, which I guess is a good way for us to segue is, so when we started this company, we started it in a recession. And everyone thought I was out of my fucking mind to start a company during a recession. And the way that, you know, my wife and I looked at it was, is if you can explain to people that you're so confident in starting a company during a recession when things are good, there's no reason why they wouldn't use you.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just in, you know, I worked as general counsel for a national title company, and, you know, my boss just wasn't with it, and, you know, he wasn't a leader. I have a 3-year-old daughter, and so essentially I read this book to her by the Berenstain Bears called The Blame Game. And his position always was, it was somebody else's fault. All the time. It was always somebody else's fault.
You going to send him a copy of that book one of these days?
He's in a place where he doesn't get books anymore.
Okay.
But
he only gets 1 hour of exercise a day.
It's something like that. And so essentially what it came down to was I couldn't get behind that. And so, so Kelly comes from a family of entrepreneurs. You know, my family had always worked for other people, but it got to a point where, you know, I kept hearing from her, you can do this, son. You guys can do this. You can do this. You can do this. And so finally, we started it. And then it's actually funny, but my boss found out I was starting a company, and he fired me via text message. And he's like, you're fired. You know why? And literally, it was the best thing that ever happened to me. It was the best thing that ever happened to me because it took the ceiling that I thought or the floor that was there and said, all right, you have no parachute. You're on your own.
When one door closes, another one always opens.
Yeah. And so literally, you know, I walked out of, you know, having a huge salary as an attorney for a national company to literally nothing in less than 15 minutes. But it literally, the fear that goes through you it's invigorating. And so I never forget what made me want to start this company and why Kelly and I started the company. It was because we knew that there was a better way to do things.
Right.
And all it did was, you know, ingrain everything in us. So I go to work every single day. I wear a shirt and tie to work every single day because I feel that you dress for the job that you want. And also for the position where you want your company to go. And for me, you know, I want us to be one of the top 100%. Entities in the state of Florida and in the other states that we do business in. You know, prime example is we have been in Florida for less than 4 years. We've been doing business here for a lot longer when we were afar. But before I came down here and kind of felt like Christopher Columbus, like on my own, looking for a territory, is we had no business down here outside of our refi national clients. And we came in here, and the way the end of year report worked, we were like, I think in like the Pinellas, Hillsborough, Polk, and like 3 or 4 other counties surrounding here, we were like in the top 10. It's pretty damn good. But I tell everybody, we have more work to get done. We have to grind. We have to continue to go. And it's not that I'm not appreciative of where we're going, but as a leader, you literally have to be able to say, I'm taking the bull by the horns. I lead by example.
Burn the boats.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And I literally go after it. You know, it's like I look at other people's territory and I say, this is going to be ours. And that's why I try to lead the charge for all of our people to always be cross-selling and to always be going after new items.
100%. So when you're making the decision then to just come to Florida, what did you fly in here? Did you drive down?
Were you living here at the time?
I was living in Colorado.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So like what was that process?
All right. You know? So it's actually kind of a funny story. And so.
Wow. Colorado to Florida.
Yeah. So it started off is that we had a license down here because we had a refi client and we were getting business. And then one person, you know, kind of popped up and goes, hey, you know what? I've heard of you through mutual, you know, clients and through some mutual contacts that we actually have in the title insurance space. Because that's the thing is the title insurance space is so closely knit. All of us know each other, even if we're in different states. We all talk. Everybody knows when other people's employees are talking to other people.
So aren't the builders and the banks and the
– Yeah.
I have a real estate attorney friend.
Yeah.
Like he does stuff with Pulte and all the big guys. And like everybody knows everybody.
Everybody knows everybody.
Yeah.
And so – Coming to Florida from Colorado, you know, it was kind of like sailing on a ship trying to plant your flag. And I was like, okay, how the hell do I do this?
It's exciting, though.
But it was exciting. I was excited every single time I got on that plane. And I literally, for 2 years, went back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And it just, and Florida just kept growing. But it started literally with one employee, you know, and I had to take a chance on them. They had to take a chance on me. And then it just blew up. It literally blew up. And again, it comes down to that, you know, you have to be the leader that other people want to get behind.
100%.
Because when I was coming down here at first, when I would talk to some people, they're like, are you out of your fucking mind? Like, I don't know who the hell you are. Why am I going to leave a job?
And so many, yeah, and it's tough too, because like, so somebody like you will, you're going to say, I'm going to do something and this is what I want to do. And you actually do it.
Yep.
That's not how most people are. Right. Most people say that they're going to do something and then they just never get around to it. You know what I mean? And it's, and what ends up happening is it's not that, you know, the people who say they're going to do it, you have to remember they never do anything. They're also pitching everybody too. So you're trying to tell people these visions that you have, and they're just so used to just hearing nothing but crap.
It's like pie in the sky to most people. And so, but what it was though, is it you know, it was almost like, you know, as if you've ever built a fire and you have a little bit of kindling. I just had to get the spark. And then as soon as I got the spark, it just started to grow and grow and grow and grow. And we've done it organically, is just by, you know, is people be like, you got to meet Mike. You got to meet Mike. Once you listen to him, you'll feel what I feel.
Right.
And that's what I sell. I sell myself as to, we can be better than what else is out there, because there are a lot of companies that do really bad work. And not to say that we haven't had our ups and downs or our faults, because we do.
Everybody does.
But the way that I take it for all of our offices is, we admit fault when we made a mistake. We don't hide from it. We don't blame anybody. We don't point the finger. We say, yeah, this was not good, or this was downright awful.
Right. And you could never be a politician.
No. No, I'm too honest. Yeah. And but I think that's what makes people want to get behind the vision that we've created, is the fact is, I expect everyone to have that same, for lack of a better term, mojo that I have, is we're here. We're not going away. We're going to continue to push forward. And if something didn't work out and we lost a customer, we're going to go back to them 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times and say, hey, you know what? This is what we've done to adapt or adjust. As I was just, you know, we had a marketing meeting yesterday. I said, it's like adapt and pivot. Adapt and pivot.
Wow.
Is something doesn't work, we change it. We just don't sit there with the same employees or the same wrong people.
Dig in.
Yeah, exactly. Is we keep moving, because I have a problem of, I don't know how to give up on anything. And if you talk to Kelly, she'll tell you that it drives her crazy, because like, I'm so pigheaded sometimes to the point I'm like, I'm going to get it right. I'm going to get it right. I'm going to get it right. Or she'll hear all the time, the next wave is coming. The next wave is coming. She's like, you always tell me there's a wave. There's always a wave coming. You know, you always got something cooking. You always got something brewing. Something's happening. You're going here. You're doing this.
Right.
So-and-so's coming on board. Because like, we were joking on the other day, because I was telling her about some other, you know, some people that we're bringing on board. And she goes, who's that? And I was like, oh, I told you about Steve. And she goes, Steve? You got a Steve? And I was like, yeah, I got a Steve. Yeah. It, you know.
So it's the gift and the curse.
Yeah. It, you know, but it's amazing though, because like, I love everyone that works for me, and I love everyone that is eventually going to come on board that works for us, because I believe that it's a mutual respect. And one of the things that I try to bring into our space, but you know, our buildings, is that this is an entrepreneurial mindset, an entrepreneurial spirit. Is there's not one way to do things. There's not a Mike way of doing things. Is you're in the office, you're doing the job. You tell me what works and what doesn't work. What can make our product better?
Right.
And I think that's the thing that a lot of companies inside of Title or outside of Title, they are stuck in their ways and go like, nope, the manual says we do it this way. This is the only way that I know how to do it. I'm sorry, but I can't turn the page because we didn't go to that next pitch.
Did you hit the nail on the head? I mean, you're just like, if you want to get a 101 business education, this is it. Because, you know, it's always the fact that you said you love your employees. That's huge.
Yeah.
So when you walk in that office every day, they can feel that vibration. You don't even have to say anything to them.
Oh, yeah.
And the fact that you stand behind them and all the different things. And you started the company at a great time, because if you can make it in a down market, when the market comes back, and there's more millionaires and billionaires created in bad markets anyway.
Yeah.
It's just a, you know.
It's like learning how to drive on an old rusty five-speed, you know.
In fact. But it's interesting you said that, because you said it's not just what Mike knows, you know. Because I was telling Jeremy the other day that Phil Knight from Nike, since he started the company, he's no longer the chairman of the board anymore. I think he stepped down, but he always encouraged everyone in that company, if they had an idea to do it better, or they had a better way or a better design, bring it to me. Bring it to me. Bring it to me.
Mm-hmm. Well, and, I tell everybody, then, don't give me problems, give me solutions.
And then you see the entire opposite. I'm going to bring him up one more time, Tom Brady, okay? But anyway, you see the entire opposite. This is a guy with a coach for 20 years, and this coach had to have it his way or it was the highway. So basically, Brady's trainer, Guerrero, that instilled that TB12. Did you see Gronk playing the other day in the game? Nothing on his forearm, no injuries, totally injury-free. And this Guerrero guy had half the Patriots on this, and Belichick threw him out of the whatchamacallit, told him he couldn't come on the plane anymore, and banned him from the sidelines. And look where Brady is now.
Yeah,
he won another Super Bowl, and Belichick's going to be scrambling for the rest of his life to find another quarterback.
Well, you know, it's amazing.
But it is amazing. No, it really is.
It's amazing just because, you know, I tell everybody is people might come because of me at first, but people stay for the employees. Is the employees are what drive us. And that's why we always...
builds the culture.
It's the culture. Yeah. Exactly. It's like I set the tone as to what the culture is that we run hard. We run like bulls. No one gets in our way. However, it's the people that have to continue to do it. So, for example, I take time every morning when I get into work, no matter what office I'm in, I go around and I say good morning to everybody because I think it's important, you know, that, you know, you're not the person that just walks up to your office, sits there, and just kind of starts grinding away.
Throw the jacket on the chair. Yeah, exactly.
One of my favorite sayings is people will never remember what you say, but they'll always remember the way you make them feel.
Mm. Correct. And that's the thing. That's a huge thing. We always try to make our people feel heard. And, yeah. You know, and sometimes... the way that we are, it doesn't work for everybody because I get it. Like, I push hard. I really do. You know, I push my people hard because I push myself hard. And I tell everybody, I would never ask you to do something that I wouldn't do myself. For example, when COVID, you know, was going on, is before I asked any person in any office to do a closing, I did it myself. Lead by example. Just don't throw your people into the fodder. If I'm willing to do it myself, then other people are willing to look at it and say, okay, it's not just words. He's not sitting in some ivory tower telling us what to do, dictating down, and then, you know, just expecting for things to occur. I think it makes a difference. And
it's a huge difference.
People can get behind. And that's, you know, it's, you know, I try to empower our people. And, you know, it's like I always ask them, what do you think would make your job better? Tell me what would make your job better.
Right,
what would make us more efficient? You know, is because we're all about efficiencies. But the problem is we're in an industry where we have all these efficiencies. We have all this technology. Is you can't forget to pick up the phone. We still have to have a human element to what we do to be able to make sure that, you know, people know what we do and that we're here. We're here to help them.
I had a friend a while ago owned a restaurant. Restaurant was kind of, you know, it wasn't like falling apart, but it was, it's getting stagnant. And he's like, I don't know what I got to do to, I said, go in and wash dishes. He's like, what? I was like, go jump in the kitchen for a full week, wash dishes, go get involved again. You know what I mean? Lead.
Yeah.
Lead by example. And here's the thing. When you do that too, I think that a lot of times when you're running companies and whatnot, it's natural to get removed from that base level because you have to. If you're going to be able to grow the company.
Oh, yeah.
But to be, like you just said, if we're going to decide that we're going to do this, then let me do it first. You know what I mean? And like, you're in the office with them. So you still can keep your fingers, you know what I mean? At the grassroots level. But like some of these guys, you know what I mean? Like with the restaurant thing, I mean, if you just show up for 3 hours once a week,
it's like watching an undercover boss when they finally step off their pedestal and they do the makeup over and they go behind the scenes. Then they realize some of the problems they have because they're seeing them firsthand.
Firsthand.
You know, I think that's a solid example because the hardest part of growing anything is it's the culture, it's the structure, and then it's how you keep everything together. Because, like, for example, it's like I joke with some people because, like, Kelly and I started this company from our basement. We didn't have enough money to be able to have a space at first. And, you know, it's like I literally would wake up at like 4 o'clock in the morning. I would do all the examinations. We'd work through it. She would do some, you know, like the marketing and the client side of it. We'd field all the calls. We'd do everything. I'd go to bed at like midnight, wake up and do it again. You know, it's like I was like working in Bangladesh. I was almost working like 24 hours a day to get, to get it off the ground. But those are the things that you do to be able to get something off the ground. And that's what I think. you know, for anyone who's listening, for any kind of, you know, is thinking about doing their own business, is you literally have to be willing to sacrifice everything.
Everything.
Like, I missed Christmas because, like, for example, we used to go down to see my folks for Christmas in Arizona. Missed Christmas for 2 years. Couldn't take the time off of work. We didn't go on vacations. You didn't do it. You have to be willing to sacrifice literally everything
in the beginning
if you want to do this thing in the beginning. Yep. And most people are not willing to do it. Oh, your guy wants to say something.
Just things of adapting, adjusting, and overcoming. Just having, I mean, I see the propeller. But everything that you have said as far as being the leader, if you're not going to do it yourself, don't ask anybody else to do it.
Yeah.
Just those five things that you said have made you successful, but I wanted to kind of point on those because it's really important that people understand that you're not going to be successful if you do not have that attitude that you just told everybody right now.
Yeah.
So for me, it's intriguing and awesome to hear you say all those things because I'm 33. I have no kids. I've never been married. I'm sitting here in a third world country. But to hear you actually say this,
we're coming down.
I've done, I've been through, it's amazing, brother. And
thank you.
Hundred percent.
Wow. When I first started out, my first company, I had beautiful logo done. I spent all sorts of money on stationery, and like that lasted like out the window. Goodbye. The second one, I just got black and white paper. I put ink on it. I worked out of my house just as Mike did, and I got to the point where I was in the inventory business.
Yeah.
I got to the point when she couldn't get to the washing machine and the dryer because they had 5,000 pairs of sneakers. I had 10,000 pairs of socks and 400 sweatshirts in the cellar. That was it. I had to go out and get a warehouse. That's exactly how it was. There was shit all over the place, and it was like, you know, I knew where it all was, but she was just so overwhelmed when she got
into
the basement.
Yeah, it's so hard for people to follow along with that, too. You know what I mean? Like, you see what it's going to look like. You see what it's going to look like. You've got other people in your circle.
That don't say.
Wives, family members, then it's hard to be able to convey that and keep their motivation and keep the positivity up with them.
So nearly impossible.
Actually, the biggest thing is he's a great administrator. I can hear just the way he talks. When I have employees, when I had 8 employees, I wanted them to all be my like family and friends. It doesn't work that way. Yeah. As much as you'd like to say it, you got to treat people the way you want to be treated. You got to be firm and tell them what you want done. And then you can reward them after the fact. But if you give them all the...
A lot of that has to do with how we grew up.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah. No doubt.
Mike, I have a question for you.
There's a picture that just pops in my head. It's where there is a boss and he's whipping people. And then there's a picture of the boss and he's leading the people, bringing them up the hill instead of him whipping them, trying to get them to do it shape.
You better throw that whip away.
Yeah.
Yeah,
no,
we can hear you.
We can hear
you.
No, you're great.
We can hear you. We can hear you. Andrew, you had a question?
So one thing we're kind of going, and there's always two loops to this. It's like, yeah, you're strict on your employees or you give them that, like, you know, like other leverage. Like, where's that middle ground? Because you say you like to give or you want your employees to bring you solutions, right?
Yeah.
But where does it become like, where's that like middle ground where you start to see it become a little invasive? Like that whole you give a guy an inch, they take it a yard type of thing. Like he starts to think that he's the boss of the company. Like, has that happened to you? And like, how do you deal with it when you feel like somebody's like kind of like, nah, like I'm trying to like run the show when they get in there?
So I think that's a good question. Mm-hmm. And honestly, what we've really have run into, and I think a lot of it kind of comes to setting the tone of like the actual culture, mm-hmm. is the fact is I tell everybody, the company is, it's not me, it's not you, it's us.
It's hard to answer, yeah.
Yeah, and so what it really comes down to is the fact is when you're bringing an idea, it's for all of us to be better. It's not just for you to be better.
Okay.
Or for me to be better, it's for all of us to be better. And so I think that's what kind of, eliminates kind of some of that causality, the causality that you just brought up is, you know, is like when somebody's pushing too much, because what we tell everybody is bring ideas. Let's talk about them, figure out if they're going to work, because everyone has an idea, but is it really something that you can do? Mm-hmm. And so what you do is like you test out the idea with a few people, yep. See if it works. And if it does, then you kind of try to implement it into the actual business. Mm. I'm tough on, you know, myself, I'm tough on people. It's like, I know that I can be hard to work for, but you know, like I said, I don't ask anyone to do something I wouldn't do myself.
Yeah.
But what it really comes down to is sometimes you have to get rid of people that are toxic or poisonous, because everyone interviews well. And then when they get in there, and if, you know, and if they don't fit well with other people, you have to get rid of toxicity, because that destroys your culture.
Yeah, change is definitely strong as the weakest link.
Yeah.
I don't mean a boss. I just mean you don't want somebody coming to work that, oh, it's my job. Oh, I got to go to work. You want somebody that's going to come and give you those ideas, that's going to come and bring their best foot forward every day. And that's why Mike said when he goes to his offices, he's not just going to the office, slamming his door, ignoring everybody. He's showing them respect just like he would if they were a boss. And a lot of the insurance field, and I'll know it's a title, but a lot of those people are their own boss.
Yeah.
They can work at their own leisure. So for him to be the way that he is, I think that it's more so changing the atmosphere of the work. These aren't workers, they're actually bosses. And when you put them in that aspect of your opinion matters, it changes the whole work atmosphere, and it brings a camaraderie of the teamwork.
Correct, because like I call everybody my colleague. You know, is like I don't walk around saying I'm the owner, I'm the boss, or anything else of the sort. Right. I don't even tell people that I'm an attorney.
Yeah.
You know, I talk to everybody like they're actual colleagues, and I tell people.
I've always been like that too.
Yeah.
Are you just, you're probably not even really comfortable with being referred like that?
Yeah, exactly. Is I just going to go about my business with that side. But I tell everybody is if you think that this is just kind of a place that, you know, this is just a landing spot, then I'm the wrong place for you, because, you know, we're going to run you out of town. Because you're not going to be able to fit in.
Right.
But, you know, one of the things about, like, starting a business is the people that you think that will have your back when you start up, they won't have your back. Is, you know, is like, or people that hope that you fall flat on your face. Because I know people, when Kelly and I started this thing, they're like, oh, yeah, we got your back. We're going to send you deals. It's going to be okay. Nothing.
Nada.
You know the people who sent me the deals? Strangers,
right?
People that we created relationships with, the people that we thought, you know, is like, you know, she had a friend, you know, and you know that, you know, they went to high school together forever. Her dad owned a huge mortgage company, and she's like, Kelly, when you get this thing going, I got you. You're gonna send business. Not one fucking deal.
Donut.
Nothing.
Zero.
And that's when, you know, and that's when her and I looked at each other and said, we're on our own.
Yeah.
You know, it's like people who thought we, you know, who we thought we were gonna do it. Don't do it. Yeah. And that's when we realize is, you know what, we get more together than apart.
Yeah.
And that was one of the things that, you know, is no matter where we've gone with this thing, is if you talk to any of the branch managers that I have, you know, they feel like this is a family and this is something that's special.
No, that we're building something. Job with that.
Yeah, because I can't be everywhere at every place.
Right.
But what I can be is a phone call or a text message away. And yes, you know, Kelly might say it's a little invasive to my personal life, but I don't know any other way to be.
It is what it is.
This is who I am.
Yep.
And, you know, it's like, and I know at some point maybe I have to work on that a little bit better, but it's like, I love what I do. I love to work.
Right.
It's like, I wake up every single day and I can't wait to get out of bed.
Right.
Like, I'm that guy. Right. And it's weird, but I don't care. I like what I do. And
well, if you really love what you're doing and you're getting
and you're getting
success doing it too, you know, winning solves a lot of attitude problems with the team, within yourself.
Well, it does, but I'll give you an example though, is when things don't go my way, I double down and work even harder. Because I can't accept failure.
Good.
And it's one of those things that, again, will drive Kelly crazy, because all I'll do is talk about things. Or I'll be like Rain Man on my whiteboard writing things down. and just knocking it out, because I don't know how to lose. Like, I'm a bad loser.
Yeah.
I don't like it.
Yeah.
So, something from experience, I can tell you, sometimes the deals you don't get are the best deals you ever had.
Yeah, that's true, too.
And I'm telling you, because sometimes the deal that you think you want, with the headaches and all the shit that comes with it,
right,
You're in a, it's a different.
It's a blessing in disguise.
It's a blessing in disguise. Yeah. You're like, I want it. And then you go, oh, no, I don't want it.
Yeah, and then you get to see what's actually happening.
But anyway, for all the people that are out there that have small businesses, Mike just mentioned something that I would like to chime in on. The bottom line is, if you want good employees, you go out and find them. I got a friend that owns 3 restaurants, and that's how he finds his employees. He goes to other restaurants and picks the best people with the best personalities. He tells them he'll pay them more, come to work for me.
I love that.
They never leave when they go with him. Yeah. But he picks people that are just like, you know, you walk in, and they're happy to see you. How many places do you walk in today, and they look at you like something's wrong with you, and they just sit there. They can't even talk to you. And then to make change, if you don't mean to offend the millennials, but if you guys don't have a computer, if I give you 2025 for an 1825 bill, it's a problem. It's just they never learn.
So yeah. So Mike, so you've only been in Florida for a few years.
Yeah.
You were in Colorado. Now you're here. You guys are still expanding. It's one thing to ride that initial wave of enthusiasm and whatnot,
yeah.
But how are you staying motivated these days?
Just in general.
What are you doing? What's the mindset like?
So we've taken it from the approach is we look at it like larger companies now is it's about market share. Our goal is market share. We want to continue to increase our brand awareness. We want market share where people are continuing to send more and more deals in to all of the offices as to where we're actually at. And what we're trying to do along the way is show people that there can be a different way to do things. And to show our employees also that their opinions, like we mentioned, matter, and their voice matters. And that's how we continue to grow. And also we are trying to do by word of mouth as well. It's just because we do, you know, obviously, you know, recruiters and everything else. Yep. But I'll be honest. The best employees I've gotten has been by someone says, hey, Mike, you need to call so-and-so. Those are the best referrals that I get. Or you know, is most of the times when recruiters call, they're just trying to kick the shit down the road.
Right.
Is so-and-so didn't work, so now I'm going to give him the mic. And, you know, and then he didn't work for Mike, then I give him the Jeremy.
And as soon as he leaves Mike, if you don't give him a good review,
yeah.
Mike's being sued.
Yeah, in the rental game, we used to call that pass the trash.
Yeah, pass the trash. Yeah, is
how is this tenant?
Like the oh, they were
fantastic.
Yeah, you know, it makes it. You know, it's very strange in like running a business, just because you're right. Is it's so easy to be complacent when you get success? It's so easy to be able to just kind of put it on autopilot and say, you know
yeah.
what, this is just going to go. The problem being is it's got to be your mental mindset and mentality is because if you're that way, your employees are going to be that way. They're like, yo, things are good. We're on easy street. You know,
yeah.
let's just keep doing what we're doing and just kind of do it. Is you have to continue to be that motivator. And by them seeing me constantly go out there, being involved in the business, I go to work every single day.
So do you set benchmarks? And the reason why I'm asking this is because I was talking with somebody the other day about sports versus business and how much I just miss sports or even like, you know, project-based things because you have a start and you have a definitive finish and then you have a break, right? But it's there's our thing and we're going to go for X amount of months or whatever.
Yeah.
And then you restart. With business, it's just – It goes, and it goes.
Well, yeah, it's like we just finished 2020. So it is. I literally got to enjoy the success that we had for one day, December 31st. And then January 1st, everything I did in 2020 didn't matter anymore. Those numbers didn't matter. Every, you know, the money didn't matter. The orders didn't matter. The growth didn't matter because that was last year. You know, everyone's looking towards me and the employees are looking towards me and saying, well, what's 2021 have in store for us?
Right.
What are we going to do? How are we going to continue to grow? How are we going to be able to continue to put more butts in the seats where there's motivation
right.
for people to get raises and everything else of the sort? So that falls on me to be able to come up with plans of attack to continue to move forward.
So looking back, and how long ago did you launch all this?
We're going on our 11th year.
Okay. So looking back 11 years ago, what are a couple of things that you've learned about growing a business that you didn't know when you got started that maybe you wish you did, and then a couple things maybe about yourself
yeah.
that you didn't realize that maybe you would change. I mean, a lot of us, you know, well, yeah. I wouldn't change anything. Well, there's some things maybe some of us would change. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So probably some of the things that I didn't know about starting a business that I would share with people is, one, as I mentioned before, the people that you think that you can rely upon that are sometimes in that inner circle won't be there. Is the thing that's most important is your spouse or your girlfriend, whatever it's going to be, that's going to be able to help you and support you on that side of it, because there's some rough days. Is when you're getting something off the ground, you literally feel like you're taking it from every single angle, and that, you know, is that this wasn't meant to be. And that, you know, is, you know, I'm not going to lie. There's days that I doubted what the hell I was doing.
And people need to know that's
normal. No one talks about
it's
that.
It's normal. And that's the thing, is all you see is like people like Bill Gates or or Bezos and, you know, is all these guys. And all you think is it was bright-eyed and bushy-tailed and, you know, it's been amazing. It's not amazing for them, and they still have crappy days.
Right.
I still have bad days, but I just don't let people see that I have a bad day.
Right.
And so the biggest thing that I can say is, you know, have that support system if it's there, and just make sure that you got someone that wants to be along for that ride, because it's a bumpy ride. You know, this, you know, being an entrepreneur is not for the faint of heart.
It's a lonely ride sometimes.
And
too.
It is a lonely ride because
if you do it by yourself, it's very lonely without being connected to it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So things like this even help out. I used to belong to business networking groups. I mean, I had a thing one time where I was in licensed apparel.
Yeah.
And I bought 21,000 Chicago Bulls jackets. So it was a $500,000 deal. I got him in, and like I was like, people had them on the internet. This is the start of the internet. They were selling them for $18. I paid them $21 for them. So I'm thinking like, well, this is going to be a problem because I owned them anyway. No one else had any of the jackets.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting there. I'll never forget this. And I'm sitting in my office, and I'm going, how am I going to get out of this? And I'm there like, I'm screwed. I got to come up with $500,000 in 4 weeks, and there's going to be a problem. So for some strange reason, I put one of the jackets on, and it was a large, and I take a large. And it was like almost an inch and a half short in the sleeve, and then the belly was short too. So I put an extra large on, and it fit me perfectly. So most people would call the company up and just, you know, say, hey, listen, these jackets aren't right. I went down to MVP Sports. I'll never forget about it. I bought a starter jacket. I bought a pro player jacket, all these licensees. I bought all the different competitors, all their jackets, and I brought them back to the office, and they all were cut completely different than this particular jacket. They were cut to size right, the right way. So I went over to the dry cleaner. I said, George, what do you think of this? You do seamstress work. What's going on? He says, oh, no, this isn't a large. It's cut wrong. So I called the guy up, and the next thing I got a call from the CEO. That's it. I'll fucking bury you. You'll never buy from us again. Blah, blah, blah. He's going nuts. I said, listen, Wally. I says, I'd keep the jackets, but they're wrong. They don't fit. I says, I'm willing to pay the $800 for the freight that it costs to get them here, which I shouldn't even have to do that, but I'll send it back. I'm going to put a seamstress guy on the plane. He'll be there Monday, you know, to spec the jackets out. I mean, yeah, he's going to come all right. Guy never showed up. I was able to send all the jackets back, but I'll tell you, before that phone call, I'm going to shit in my pants. I'm going, this is a $500,000 bill. How am I ever going to pay for these, you know? Yeah.
Well, and I think that's a solid...
It just worked out.
No, it's a solid story because... Over the 11 years, there have literally been moments where I'm sitting in my office and I'm like, how am I going to make this work? What am I going to do? Because everyone thinks that I make the right decision all the time. I make bad decisions. The problem being is, oh yeah.
Like everybody else.
Yeah, is like, I tell my employees, it's adapt and pivot.
Yep.
Adapt and pivot is, okay, I have this situation. It's not going any way. I need to fix it. Because one of the things that I do that I guess goes back to a little bit of the advice is, just because you're having a shitty day doesn't mean your employees have to have a shitty day. Because I've had so many bosses over the years where if something's wrong in their personal life or in their work life, it's everyone's problem.
Yeah, they make it miserable for everybody.
Correct. And sucks. I've never been that. It's like when I have a problem, I shut my door, I figure it out, and I go about my business. Yep. My employees don't have bad days because I'm having a bad day.
Right.
I think that's one of the things in starting a business is because there's stressful moments. It's just because, you know, you might be cash strapped or things aren't going the way you want to do. Your employees don't need to be like your tell-all book. They don't need to know the problems that you're having. They want you to come up with solutions.
And that's why you can get away with telling them, come to me with solutions,
correct,
not problems. If you're just walking around ranting about everything wrong,
correct,
you cannot, again, you can no longer demand that of anybody.
It goes back to what I said, lead by example. And that's the hardest part is you got to be the leader that they want. Not the leader that they think that they're going to see on television.
Right.
It's like it's got to be something special.
Right.
And that's kind of what I've always tried to do in starting the business. And, you know, and I tell everybody, because people come to me like, oh, I want to start my own business. I was like, good for you. What do you want to do? What's your business plan? And they, and most of them go, well, I haven't really thought about it. And I said, think about it this way. You know, before you leap, you got to look. Look at what you're going for. Come up with some goals. Figure out what you're going to do before you go throw in the towel at like your actual job.
At the very least, come stop and people, by Startup Street.
You know, or I'm sorry, yeah. Or go talk to Jeremy at Startup Street with a little plug.
But that's Startup Street.
That's a really good point, because you know something? People, you don't have to be all in. If you're thinking of doing something, you can try it out, make a couple of things and put them on Etsy or whatever and see how it goes. Yeah. Try it out. You don't have to jump into it with both feet.
Yeah, like,
you know. I'm still, yeah. Yeah. That story's not a bull story either. But anyway, the other thing is that Mike hit the nail on the head for all entrepreneurs that are just, you know, they can't figure stuff out. You go in your office and you shut your door and you think about the problem. You don't react with your emotions and get on the phone and pick it up and go, you motherfucker, come get these jackets. It doesn't work like that. If you want more, you get more bees with honey than you do without.
You really do. Took me a very, very long time
really
to learn that.
When you think about it, the problem, and figure your way to fix it, you know. And lots of times it's not even as big as you think it is.
You know, and it's funny that you said that, because I used to be very hot-headed when I was younger, when it would come to that. And I would snap.
That was one of the things I was waiting. I thought you were going to bring up.
Yeah.
When.
Yeah, is like, I'm like, because like, I'm such a high energy person, and you know, is like, I like to be right. And so one of the things is,
and I'm doing it now.
Yeah, is I would literally just put people in their place, like other vendors and things. I would just snap back like that. One of the things I had to learn is take a moment, think through it, type it out. And if I'm still good with it, an hour later, I hit send.
And
you know, and every once in a while I'll catch myself like where somebody pisses me off and I'm about to pick up the phone and I'm gonna ream out somebody, because you know, it's like we all have competitors, we all have vendors, things that, you know, piss us off sometimes.
Shit goes wrong
the
time.
It's never going to go away.
Right.
And the biggest thing that I've just learned over the time is in starting a business is, like you said, you get more bees with honey than with vinegar. Is no one wants to work with the guy that flies off the handle. You know, is they want to work with the guy that says, all right, Jeremy, all
right,
you screwed up my website. Things aren't good. I'm getting all this porn spam coming through the filters. You know, it's like, I know, like, I'm very angry with you, but how do we fix it? But if I call and go, you're an idiot.
Right, exactly.
You screwed me. You took my money. It's like, you're going to be like, well, you know what?
Yeah,
I might have screwed up, but, you know, I'm going to let him wait a day or two. But if I call you go, look, man, I'm in trouble. I need your help. You're going to say, all right, come by the shop. 100%. Let's see what's going on. Let me see how I can help fix it.
After COVID, either of those, it just depends on who you're talking to.
Yeah.
Because I've been in both of those situations within the last couple of months. I sold a truck to somebody before I left. He owes me a couple of $100. It's not about that. It's about I helped him when he was in need.
Yep.
And I'm telling him, hey, you got my money and nothing. So in that aspect, I think, you know, calling him up saying, hey, where the F is my money?
Yep.
Yeah. You know,
well, yeah, I mean, bro. Yeah,
or if you owe the money, you call them up and say, hi.
Yeah, man. Go get it.
Or if you owe them money, if you owe them, you call up and say, hey, how you feeling?
Well,
have you been sick?
Well, exactly. And I'm not going to pretend that I'm like the sweetest man on earth over here. Is if somebody owes me money, they owe
me
money.
Right, exactly.
Is, you know, it, you know.
And it's a feel thing.
Yeah.
You know.
Is certain things, I will scorch earth where I need to.
Right.
You know, but it's not an everyday occurrence where, you know what, I'm lawyering up and saying, okay, we're taking everything.
Right.
But, you know, it's like, it reminds me of a funny story. Is like, so when we were doing the work, a guy one time, he wrote me a bad check for like $40,000. He was closing on a piece of property. It didn't go through. You know, it turned into a whole issue where he owed me about $40,000. Well, it's an escrow account. He wrote me a bad check. I have to go get the money from him. So he ignores. I have to put the money into the account. So I'm taking a $40,000 hit. And I told the guy, I said, make it right. Don't make me go the other route. You know what? I thought about it, Mike, and you can go fuck yourself. And I said, okay. I said, you want to rephrase that for me before you see what really go fuck yourself means.
Right.
And he goes, nope, I'll stick with that. I said, okay. I said, you know what? Have a great day, because this will be the last great day that you have. So it takes... Oh, yeah. It literally goes... So he doesn't hear anything for a little bit. And I was like, okay. So I do the legal thing. He owes me a check. He wrote me a bad check. He doesn't realize that when, you know,
it's
in
a felony.
States,
that's
yeah.
a felony.
Yeah. Exactly. So especially I go that route. No, no, no. It gets better. I said, you know what? I said, the way that I want to handle this is, you know what? I'm going to teach this guy a lesson. He might be 50 years old, and I'm 30, you know, and I'm 30 something at the time, but, you know, I'm going to show him that, you know what? This isn't how you treat people.
Right.
Cops lock him up. So I go through the criminal side of it. However, because I'm a kind guy, I also go the civil route, and I say, you know what? Getting in trouble with the, you know, the felony isn't really enough. We're going to go the other route. You have a church that was deeded to you by your grandfather, and it means the world to you. You supposedly have no money. I go and I get a judgment. I get the judgment. I record the judgment against the church. At that standpoint, we take it a step further. It's foreclosure time.
Uh-oh.
He's hemming and hawing. He's begging. Please don't do this. Please don't do this. This church has been in my family for 200 years. Blah, blah, blah. I said, I'm sorry, but I remember you telling me to go fuck myself. And he goes, I'm really sorry, Mike. That was just the wrong thing. You caught me on the wrong day. And I said, you know what, man? I said, I gave you so many chances to make this right. And I said, I feel the only way to be able to make me right is we need to follow through with this. Because other people need to know that you just don't write bad checks and then think that I'm going to cough up the money. Because I've been without my money for about a year and a half while I tracked you down.
Right.
We foreclosed on his church. It went to sale. He hemmed and he hawed and he begged and pleaded. It got sold.
Really?
He lost his church. Moral of the story? In business?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Wouldn't it be great if he became a pastor and came out and did the sermon before the church?
Well, my wife had made the joke while we foreclosed on it. You can have the church and Mike because you have so many followers.
There you go. Yeah. Nice.
But it is like it goes to his point. Is every scenario, yes, you do have to kind of be a little bit, because you have to stick up for yourself. Because the other side of our industry, or in any industry, is if people think that they can walk on you, you're going to have problems.
Yeah.
And so, yes, it, you know, is to your point, I try everything possible to not need for that side of me to come out, because I don't want that to be
it's
my
a
normal
thing.
But
know?
It's a feel thing.
It is
when you have to go that route, like any business, you got to get your money back, because no one can be in the business of writing $40,000 checks, $10,000 checks, or, you know, $500,000 starter jackets. Is like
wrongly sized starter jackets.
Is you have to stand up for yourself and your business, because it goes to, if you don't respect yourself, no one's going to respect you.
And that makes life very difficult.
And you know something? The interesting thing is, don't ever be afraid of the DAs or the judges or any of that shit, because I'm telling you right now, if I knew what I knew now, because I was living in Massachusetts in, what's the company? Overstock.com. They had just started out. So they had a customer, because we had bought 2.6 million hats, and they had a customer wanted to buy 20,000 hats down here. Sent him all the stuff with COD tags on them. It was $450 in COD tags. He goes, I'm not paying that. I says, fine. It's just tell the guy, take all the tags off. I mean, leave all the tags on. I'll reimburse the check for $450. No, no, no. I'm only taking it with the one tag. So I basically told the guys, my partner, I said, listen, you ship this shit, it's on you, because I know what he's going to do. He's going to keep all the boxes except for the one with the COD tag, and he's keeping them all. Sure than shit, he did it. We're out $21,000. I called a detective down here. He said, this guy's a scumbag. He's been doing this for years. I'm going to nail him. Had a beautiful case against him, and the DA calls up, and he goes, it's a civil matter. It's not a criminal matter. And I'm there, what do you mean it's a civil matter? If I knew what I knew now, I would have told the DA, if you think it's a civil matter, the news channels will be there in 2 hours, because I'm going to tell them how you operate your office. You can't be afraid of them, because, you know, it's just the shit that they do is unbelievable.
Yeah.
It's now, if you put a high-profile name to it, 10 seconds later, they'll be down with a warrant trying to
bring the guy to jail.
And that kind of goes to my point of, like, the story. It's a funny story. Now, going through it, it sucked because we were at a position when we first started the company that was a big...
That's a major cash flow hit.
It was a major cash flow hit because the underwriter requires that you put the money in.
Right.
It's a not-my-problem kind of situation. So it was... On top of all the other things I'm dealing with the fact now I'm putting money into like a bit.
It's an escrow account. You should have known better.
Correct.
That's against the law.
Exactly. Exactly. So it was just a bad.
So did the guy apologize to you after he lost his shirt, John?
No, he told me to go fuck myself again.
Again?
But it was too late. I put him the voicemail at that standpoint.
Well, I'm glad you told me to go fuck myself, because if you buy another church, I want to hear from you.
Yeah, there you go.
But no.
So listen, we got to get wrapped up here, okay?
Thank you guys for your time. I had a lot of fun.
Mike, I really...
Watch who you tell to go fuck yourself.
Exactly. No, that story there just made the whole entire thing worth it. And your team is going to love hearing that story if they don't know it already. So
I don't tell it very often, actually.
No, you don't. I know you don't. So, Mike, for anybody that's interested in possibly working with you in whatever capacity, how do they get a hold of you? Where can they find you guys?
Yeah, so essentially our website is tiagotitle.com, T-I-A-G-O-T-I-T-L-E. com, and my email is mike@tiagotitle.com. We're always happy to help you guys on any transactions, and if you're just starting off in real estate as well, all of our offices are more than happy to help and teach people along the way to be able to kind of, you know, is if you're walking through your first deal, if you're an investor or if you're buying your deal, is like we made our pay dirt in the very beginning of starting this company by I literally used to help people read their title commitments for deals that weren't even mine just to be able to get some type of credit with people to be able to say, hey, you know what, I helped one of your buyers out. When you get your next deal, send me a deal.
Is
like we've always tried to be able to go that extra mile to help people out. So, and we still do that to this day. We're always here to help people.
Nice. I love it. Well, listen, guys.
Thank you guys
for
having me.
Yeah, I appreciate everybody listening.
That was great.
Yeah. Make sure you subscribe, follow, all that good stuff.
Appreciate it, brother. Best of luck down there.
Until next time. 40. I really should just let it record all the way through like I did last time, huh?
Yeah, I guess so.
Oops.